Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we shall be discussing about hydrology and hydrological cycle. Hydrological cycle appears to be very simple, but this is not simple, this is very complex as it contains a number of different processes. So, what are different processes which are involved in the hydrological cycle and how we go for the hydrology, etc. These all things will be discussed in this module. The learning objectives of this module are to understand the basic concepts of the hydrology cycle and its components, to empathize on the water balance concepts, to correlate the role of hydrological cycle with the environmental and biochemical cycles on the earth. Before we start for a hydrological cycle, let we try to understand about distribution of gases in the atmosphere. You all know that air is a mixture of gases. About 78% component of the air, this air is nitrogen, and about 21% is oxygen, about 0.9% is argon, and 0.03% is carbon dioxide. These are the major gases. In addition to this, some minor and trace gases are also present. Along with these gases, water is also present in the atmosphere in the form of vapors. The percentage of water vapors may vary from 0.05% to 4% at different places. The water vapors in the air are causative factor for the formation of mist, fog, clouds, rain or snow. Similarly, carbon dioxide also play an important role in plant life and climate of the earth. This interaction of carbon dioxide, water vapors with the solar radiations is responsible for the water circulation in the atmosphere, or in other words, we can say that solar radiations are the source of energy for hydrological cycle. In this figure, the budget of solar radiations is shown. You will find that the solar radiations which are coming from the sun, 51% of them are absorbed by earth surface, about 19% of them are absorbed by atmosphere and clouds, about 6% are reflected by atmosphere, about 20% of the incoming solar radiations are reflected by clouds, and about 4% of the solar radiations, incoming solar radiations, are reflected by the surface. So, these solar radiations, carbon dioxide and water vapors, they play a very important role in the overall climate of the earth. Now, let me come to the hydrological cycle. The hydrological cycle is formed by the combination of several processes, including evaporation, evapotranspiration, condensation, precipitation, and runoff. The total water sources of the earth remains constant. Yes, this is very interesting. Since the earth has formed, even not a single drop of the water has lost from this earth. You know that when water is evaporated from the earth, it moves upward, and at higher altitudes, temperature is low. When it goes upward and temperature is low and pressure is also lesser, then it is converted into liquid form and ultimately come back to the earth. And sun, as I told you earlier, that sun is the source of energy for the hydrological cycle. The hydrological cycle has two main components. One is the transportation component, that is the movement of the water in the hydrological cycle, and second component is the storage component. This figure shows the forms and movement of water in the hydrological cycle. In this figure, you will find that this process starts basically from evaporation from the oceans. And in this evaporation from ocean, the maximum amount of water is converted from liquid phase to the vapor phase. And this phenomena take place by convection. When these vapors goes in the atmosphere at higher altitude, then these vapors converted into liquid droplets by the process of condensation. Here it is interesting to know that the molecular mass of water is lesser than the oxygen and nitrogen. When the molecular mass of water is lesser than nitrogen, oxygen, which are the major gases of the air, then these water vapors are less dense, their density is lesser, and when their density is lesser, then they are easily move in upward direction. And now in the atmosphere, when water condensation take place, that convert these evaporated water into liquid, and that ultimately leads to formation of clouds. And these clouds move from one place to the other place all over the earth, and ultimately, yes, the movement of these clouds take place by advection. Then precipitation process is by which these liquid water from the atmosphere come back to the earth. And similarly, in addition to this, some water that is present in the ice and snow, that either get evaporated by the process of sublimation, or some water of this after melting that moves to the rivers or our streams. Some water goes to the groundwater through the phenomena of infiltration, and evapotranspiration is another phenomena in which water is transported from the earth to the atmosphere. So, as I told in the beginning, this phenomena, this hydrological cycle, appears to be very simple, but this is not very simple, this is very, very complex, as it contains a number of physical processes in it. Yes, this figure shows the typical hydrological cycle in a very simple way. Here you will find again same thing, that evaporation is taking place from the ocean, and cloud formation is taking place, and in the clouds condensation is taking place, and movement of the clouds is taking place by the advection, and ultimately precipitation take place, then evapotranspiration take place, sublimation take place, then infiltration take place, and the runoff from streams to the oceans take place. So these are the processes which are involved in a typical hydrological cycle. Now, let me come to the different components of hydrological cycle. The transportation components of hydrological cycle include precipitation, evaporation, transportation, infiltration, and runoff. Whereas storage components are those components which store the water on the land surface, and storage components include ponds, lakes, reservoirs, etc., soil moisture storage, and groundwater storage. Let me have a look on the water budget of the earth. About 97% of the total water that is present on this earth is present in the form in the oceans, and that water cannot be directly used by the man, that we will be discussing in the another paper of water pollution. And about 70% of the remaining 3% water is present in the ice caps and glaciers. About 1% of the total water is present as groundwater. So this is the total water budget of this earth. As I told in the beginning, since the earth has formed, even not a single drop of the water has lost from this earth. A wonderful ceiling in the form of tropopause has been given by the nature, that water is not going to be ever lost from the earth. Now, let me come to different factors, those affect the hydrological cycle. There are two main factors that affect the hydrological cycle, and these include human interferences and El Nino effect. The alternation between the normal climate and a different recurrent set of climatic conditions in the Pacific region is called as El Nino. The term El Nino was originally used by fishermen along the coast of Ecuador and Peru to a warm ocean current appearing around the period of Christmas over several months. The Earth's rotation deflects the surface currents northward in the northern hemisphere, and southward in the southern hemisphere. As a result, the surface water deflected away from the equator in both direction and away from the coastline. As a result, colder nutrient water comes up from below to replace it, and this phenomena is called as upwelling. This figure shows the El Nino phenomena. What is El Nino and how El Nino occur and what are the effects? This will be discussed in other modules. The winds that blow along the equator affect the properties of upwelled water. In the absence of the wind, the dividing layer between the warm surface and the deep colder water is called thermocline and it would be flat. As the winds drag the surface westward, raising thermocline up to the surface in the east and depressing it in the west. So, this is about El Nino. Now, let we come to the hydrology. Hydrology is a branch of geology that deals with the occurrence, use and functions of surface water and groundwater. It includes chemical, physical, biological and legal aspects of surface and groundwaters. The rainfall distribution both in space and time, intensity, frequency and variability is of considerable importance for understanding hydrological aspects of any given area. Here this figure shows the components of hydrogeology. You will find the main components of hydrogeology are hydrology, pedology and soil physics. In addition to this, a number of other sciences are also involved in the hydrogeology, and these sciences include geochemistry, geobiology, geophysics, geomorphology, hydrogeology, hydrogeophysics, hydroecology, hydroclimatology, soil chemistry, soil biology, soil fertility, soil mechanics, etc. What I want to say that hydrogeology is very complex subject. If you want to study this subject, you must have knowledge of number of other subjects which I have just now described. Now, let me have a look on the movement of surface water. After a dry rainless period, when rainfall occurs, large portion will be lost through evaporation and surface runoff. A rapid runoff would mean minimum percolation into the earth, and even if the rains are normal. Saturation runoff occurs after soil water zone is fully saturated. Infiltration of water is the downward movement of water from the groundwater. The maximum infiltration rate is the infiltration capacity. The water percolation is the transit of infiltrated water by gravity through the zone of aeration to the zone of saturation. This figure shows the vertical distribution of groundwater. The water present in the earth crust is called as groundwater. When groundwater is deep inside the earth's surface, there forms a zone of open spaces filled with air known as zone of aeration, or also called as Vadose zone. Vadose zone has a pressure head less than atmospheric pressure. Now, let me come to the groundwater. Zone of saturation present in any part of the geological formation and forms when pore spaces or fracture zone in them are filled with water through infiltration and or percolation. It lies between the water table and impermeable strata. The upper surface of the zone of saturation is the water table or phreatic surface. Rate of water percolation and groundwater recharge is dependent upon the rock characteristics in the Vadose zone. When there is impermeable rock in the zone of aeration, downward movement of infiltrated water get blocked or restricted, resulting in the saturation of the interstices of the rock material above the impermeable barrier. Now let me discuss about aquifers. What is an aquifer? An aquifer is the rock formation or part of rock formation which yields appreciable quantity of groundwater and had capacity to store water, which is expressed as storage coefficient. It includes confined, unconfined and semi-confined aquifers. Confined aquifers are those aquifers which are covered by a impervious layer, as well as at the bottom also they have a impervious layer. Means the water cannot be percolated in these confined aquifers from the earth, that is just above the aquifer. Rather, the water is percolated in the confined aquifers from the far away places. Normally, the pressure in the confined aquifers is more than the atmospheric pressure. So, we can say that unconfined aquifers are covered by a permeable earth, and water is directly infiltrated in them from the earth that is just above them. Whereas in case of semi aquifers, we can say there is some kind of leaking, means at the bottom they have a completely impervious layers, whereas at the surface they have somewhat lesser impervious layers, means some water can infiltrate in the semi confined aquifers from the top. When we talk about the flow of a liquid, then Darcy law comes into picture, and Darcy law was given by Henry Darcy based upon his experiment which he did on the movement of water through the porous materials. Darcy law states that the amount of groundwater discharged through a given portion of aquifer is proportional to the cross-sectional area of flow, hydraulic gradient and hydraulic conductivity. Darcy law is expressed as K is equal to Q divided by A into I, where Q is equal to the quantity of water discharged in unit time, A is equal to the total cross-sectional area through which water percolates, and I is the hydraulic gradient. Now, let me come to the groundwater recharge. Groundwater recharge is dependent upon the porosity and permeability of the soil and underlying geological formation that prevails in that particular area. Porosity is the pore space between unconsolidated soil and other earth material and weathered and fractured part of the rock. Permeability is the expression of the connectivity of pores to permit the wave movement. Okay. Now, to summarize this module, in this module we have learnt about different processes which operate in the hydrological cycles. We have also learnt about different factors that affect the hydrological cycles. In addition to that, we have learnt what is the aquifer and what are different types of aquifer, and for the motion of water or for the flow of water, Darcy law is very, very important. We have learned that what is Darcy law, and we have learned little bit about groundwater recharge. Thank you.